get our songbooks, turn to page 85, just over in the glory land. Let's stand together while we sing that. Everybody standing, page 85 in your songbooks. But it's 336, and simply says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. That's a great promise from God. Amen. Let's sing that together. 336 in your songbooks. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall
something with you. Some of you at this point don't treasure memories like some others. We know memories. I'm telling you this because this song here, just over in the glory land, not too long ago, Brother Shelton and I visited the old home place and the porch that Dad and I sat on, and I sat on his knee and he would sing this song. Now, Dad didn't get saved till later in years, but there lay that old porch on the ground, and what flooded my heart was sitting on his lap, listening to him sing. I think sometimes he hit the right key, too. I think he did. But just memories. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Brother Ayers, lead us as we pray, please.
Father, what a privilege it is to be in the house of your word tonight, Father. Yes. We are so thankful for Jesus and the eternal salvation that he provides, Father, Amen. So that we know that we can be with you in glory land and with our loved ones someday, Father. We just thank you and praise you for that. Father, we'd ask that you be with the service, open our hearts and our minds. Father, help us as we sing at the choir. Father, help us to honor and glorify you in everything we say and do. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. May we see you.
Let's take our songbooks, 183, Come and Dine the Master Calleth. Remain seated while we sing that. 183 in your songbooks. Attitude.
All right, just a couple of announcements. In fact, I'm going to go ahead and ask the ushers just to come on forward. I don't have much to say here. Don't forget teenagers. January 28th, we're going bowling and then going to Foster's Grill right afterwards. So don't forget about that. $10 for the bowling and then whatever money you need to go eat. That's up to you. I recommend more than $2 or $3 for Foster's Grill, though. Okay, so just keep that in mind. Also, January 29th is our fifth Sunday special offering, so just be in prayer about what God have you to give specially on that day. And then keep in mind, no greater love Sunday for February the 12th, a special day there. Okay? All right, let's have a prayer for the offering. Brother Pierce, if you would, say the blessing.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gathering of all those who were able to make it here this evening. We ask you to please reach out and touch all those people that couldn't make it, that wanted to make it, Lord. And Lord, please bless this offering, bless the gift and the giver, and help us to get through this evening and everyone be inspired in some form or fashion. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
Announcement. He didn't know I was going to do this, but Luke Wilson is going on a missions trip this coming summer with the school, correct? And where are you going? Guatemala? Going to Guatemala, okay? Tomorrow at Foster's Grill here in Warrenton, if you go to eat there for lunch or dinner or whatever, I encourage you to do that for tomorrow. Mention Fresno Valley Christian School for the missions trip, correct? And it'll go towards, they'll donate 20%. Towards their of whatever you buy, 20% of it will go towards their missions trip. So if you go out that direction tomorrow and you want a hamburger, go there and mention Fresno Valley for their missions trip.
Right. We have one birthday to take care of that I know of, and that's today, January the 15th. Brother Frank Padilla got a birthday. That's that short guy standing over there. Yeah, stand up tall, brother, where people can see you. Okay, any other birthdays? All right, you're it. Have a seat. Let's all stand and sing Happy Birthday. Happy Birthday to you. Happy Birthday to you. Happy Birthday. God bless you. Happy Birthday to you. Amen. Let's take our songbooks again. 337, Trust and Obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. Amen. 337 in your songbooks.
Okay. Book of Mark, chapter 16, if you would. As we continue on tonight with what we started looking at last week. Mark chapter 16, we'll reread the text that we were in. We're talking about being good stewards of our testimony and the truth. And tonight speaks more of our testimonies. Last week we talked about the truth quite a bit. Mark chapter 16, we're going to start reading in verse 15 and read down through verse 20. And he said unto them, Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven, and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them, and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. Father, I pray that you just speak to our hearts about being good stewards, Lord, all throughout this month as we look at this emphasis, and God, as we look at what the Word of God says about it. God, we heard a good message this morning, very challenging to us. We thank you for it. God, we ask you throughout this month, continue to work in us and make us better stewards of what you've given us. Lord, help us as we look at the truth and our testimony tonight. Speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name I do pray. Amen. All right, last week we had looked at the requirements given to the saints of God as far as being stewards, more last week of being stewards of the truth. Now, that's included in what we're looking at this week, but this week speaks more of our testimony. We're looking at this week the recognition of his servants. How is a child of God recognized? You ever stopped and thought about that? We talk about it quite a bit. How should you be recognized as a child of God? When people look at you, when your coworkers look at you, when your neighbors look at you, what do they think of that can give away that you're a child of God, that you're a Christian? How are you recognized? That's what we're looking at. And of course, that speaks of our testimony. You know, Jesus here, and we mentioned this last week, he ends his words with his disciples. He's about to ascend up into heaven. He ends by telling them that there's going to be signs that would follow true believers. The word signs here refers to a token or that which separates. Think about that for a second. Now think about our Sunday school lesson this morning. The Holy Spirit sanctifies. He causes us to live a holy life, a separate life. It's a lot of what we're looking at right here. This word talks about, it means that God will put a difference between his people and the people who are lost in sin. There's a difference there. The word follow, you think down there in verse 20, confirming the word with signs following. In verse 17, and these signs shall follow them that believe. It talks about it accompanies them. What kind of tokens, signs, works that God has done in your life follow you? Another way you can say it, what evidence is there that follows you? The word tokens there, when you speak of the word token, it means it's a mark of separation. Or in what we're looking at here, a proof of your salvation. Proof of it. These things will accompany your life if you're a good steward of God. This is almost a repeat of some of the message Pastor preached to us this morning. These things follow our lives as a Christian. And of course, also these verses have been misunderstood by many. They try to trust salvation in more than just simple faith in Jesus. There's many who want a token along with their salvation to, you know, some kind of wonder, a tangible sign. You know, from these verses right here that we read, talking about serpents and devils and drink any deadly thing that shall not hurt them, laying hands on the sick, they shall recover. Many people take these out of context and said, you're only really truly saved. You only really truly have the power of God on you if you do these things. We'll get to that here in just a little bit. But the actions described in these verses refer to events. They took place in the early days of the church. They did take place. There were times. We read some of the examples God gave to us in the book of Acts, where they took up serpents and got bit. They should have died. They lived. They were poisoned, but they lived. There's ones that, how many times do we see in the book of Acts where somebody was healed? Yeah, I wish it more than anything that God would let me bring my dad, and I wouldn't hit him too hard upside the head. No, but I'd pat him on the head and say, you're healed, and his dizziness is gone. Wouldn't that be a blessing? I wish it could do that, but we don't see that today. Why is that? You see, the Bible's very clear. When the apostolic period ended, the need for those kinds of miracles and signs and wonders, they ceased to function. Speaking in tongues, we don't do that today. It ceased. The Bible's very clear about that. Why did they cease? You've read this verse before, I'm sure, but go to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians. I just want to make this clear. This isn't the emphasis tonight, but the world gets this very confused. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, look in verse 8. Verse 8, it says, charity never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. Look at this verse 10. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. There in verse 10, that little phrase right in the middle there, but when that which is perfect is come. Guess what we have today that is perfect, that every single one of us are holding, I hope you are, holding in your hands reading from right now? The Word of God. We have the when the apostolic age was done, the Word of God was finished. It had been penned down, it had been recorded, and God was going to, and God preserved it. It was done. That which is perfect, we have. They did not have that during those times. So God sent signs and wonders, such as picking up serpents. Aren't you glad, Brother Carter, you didn't have to go while the choir was singing that song and go back there and pick up a rattlesnake out of the box and start dancing around with it? That would be a sight, wouldn't it? Well, we don't do that today. Why? Because we have what is perfect. We have the revelation of God given to us right here. We don't need those kinds. Now, does God still work miracles today? Sure he does. Every day. All the time. You know, every time a soul gets saved, it's a miracle of God. But how many times have we prayed for people that were sick? Doctor said, there's no hope. Can't do anything for them, and they get well. Not always, but it does happen. According to God's will. Only God can do those things. And things that we pray for that we look at and say there's no hope, but God works it out in a miraculous way. God still works miracles, doesn't he? Praise the Lord for that. But don't be confused and don't let the world confuse you or question you. You know, well, if you were really of God, you would be doing these things. The Bible says it right here. Now you can explain it to them. Listen, we don't need to do those things anymore. Those things have ceased. We have the perfect word of God to show us what the truth is. And who God is. God has chosen, you're there in 1 Corinthians, flip back to chapter 1. God has chosen, if it's not through signs and wonders, what has he chosen to get the truth out? Look what it says here in chapter 1, verse 21. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. It's through preaching the Word of God. Now we looked at last week, we looked at there's different ways that we preach the Word of God. Verbally through our mouth, we witness to people, we share the gospel with them, but also with our testimonies. We are to be good stewards of both of those things. Of sharing the gospel, we looked at last week. This week, we're looking more and emphasizing in our testimonies. While God can still do miracles, he can still send signs to confirm his message, the greatest miracle in the world today is the lives of those he has changed through the power of the new birth. That's the greatest testimony of all. It's to see somebody who was lost and in sin, and somehow, some way, he received Christ as a Savior, and everything's changing now. That's a miracle. I've shared the testimony before of the first missionary that we worked with down in Puerto Rico. His name is Steve Buchanan. He was a rough and tough man. He was a filthy man. He'll give his testimony. He says, I had one of the dirtiest mouths you've ever heard. But he said, when I got saved, that all changed. When he'd cuss, all of a sudden, he'd feel bad. And something hurt about that. He wasn't supposed to be doing that. So he stopped. Places he would go to, all of a sudden, he'd walk in the door there, and I shouldn't be here. His friends started seeing that. His quote-unquote friends started seeing. His lost friends started seeing that. They saw a difference in him, and they were asking him about it, wondering, what's happened to you? It's exactly what we're talking about right here. The miracle of salvation. The miracle of a changed life because of the new birth. Listen, God has saved us. And like we talked about this morning in Sunday school, he set us apart. We have a purpose. You know, I guess the older I get, the more interested I get in these types of things. I get myself in trouble more than what I think. But Brother Tom, he talks me into it most of the time. When there's something broke on the car, oh, you can fix that. Here's what you do. So I go out and buy the tool that's supposed to do it. Brother Tom, you work with tools a lot more than I do. Does it drive you crazy when somebody uses a tool in a way it's not supposed to be used? With a backhoe, especially something expensive, especially. It's not meant to do that, right? That tool was made for a specific purpose. Folks, when you got saved, God saved you for a specific purpose. He set you apart for his use now. For his use. Go to 2 Corinthians. You're there in 1 Corinthians. Flip over a few pages. Chapter 5, look in verse 17, read down through verse 20 there. We know verse 17, we're very familiar with 17, but don't stop there. Look at verse 17, we'll start there. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, behold, all things become new, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Look at verse 20. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. Folks, when you got saved, you were made a new creature, and you are now a representative, an ambassador of Jesus Christ. How much more can we describe our stewardship responsibility when it comes to our testimony? We are to be a representative, someone who represents how Christ acts, how Christ talks, how Christ dresses. How Christ just carries his testimony in every way that we live. You know, the world, back here in the New Testament here, the world saw the miracles that God allowed the apostles of the first century to do. And they knew that that message was from God. There was no question about it. It was evidence of God's power on them. Of God in their life. The world, even today, sees holiness, faith, simple obedience in the lives of any Christian, and knows that that is a message from God. They can't help but recognize this isn't normal. This isn't something that is of man. This is something that God is doing in that person's life. This is something that God's power is on them and has made this change in them. You know, there's still a mark today, just like the apostles there. There's still a mark on us today. There is. It's not the mark of a lame man being able to walk again. It's not the mark of picking up a serpent and getting bit but not dying from it. It's not the mark of drinking some Kool-Aid, amen? It has something in it. We don't do that. Those aren't the marks we're talking about today. It's the mark of a changed life. A changed life. And you know, don't use the excuse, well, I don't really have a fancy testimony. Outside of, I mean, just as fancy as anybody else. Don't get me wrong. God saved me. Amen. But I wasn't in some deep, dark life of sin before. I got saved when I was 13 years old. You can only do so much as a 13-year-old kid. I grew up in a Christian home. Now, I gave them enough trouble when I was 13 years old. But I hear some people say and just talk about the horrible things they did before they got saved. I don't care if you have a horrible testimony, a horrible life that you came out of, or if you grew up in the perfect Christian home. You are still marked. You still have just as powerful of testimony as anyone else. If you're a good steward of it. The Lord promises us. He promises us to authenticate. Now think about that. The Lord Jesus Christ promises to authenticate those who are His. You don't have to do it yourself. It's not up to your own power to do this. It's just simply being a good steward of what God has given us in our lives, in our testimony, and with His truth. And as long as we obey Him, He takes care of the rest. He authenticates that. He does this how? Like we already said, changing their lives and recreating His life within us. Isn't that a blessing? Isn't that something? That is a miracle within itself. Go to Galatians chapter 2. Look at a couple passages here. Galatians chapter 2. Look in verse 20. Paul here's talking to the church in Galatia, and he's given a really just his testimony here. Look what he says. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I. Look at the next phrase there. But Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me. You know, when we're a poor steward of our testimony, that verse is quite different. We can't claim that verse as a poor steward, because the life we try to live is not the life of Christ. We try to live our own life, what we want to do, how we think things should be, how we want things to go. But when we're a good steward, this is a good testimony that we can have. It's not our life that we live. It's the life of Christ within us. Look over in Ephesians chapter 4. Look in verse 13. Ephesians chapter 4, look in verse 13. We're going to read down through verse 15. It says, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of man, and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. Folks, we can live a Christ-like life. We're called to do that. Part of being a good steward of your testimony is allowing Christ to live in you and change you. For you to live out what Christ wants you to live. Not what I want to live. I'm not the only one in here. I know that's a battle. That's tough to do. There's a lot of times during the week, especially when I'm out dealing with other people and other situations and such out in this world, we want to get in the flesh, don't we? It's very tempting. But we can't. We must be a good steward of the life that we live, of our testimony. Why? Because that preaches the truth. It preaches the truth of the gospel. It preaches the truth of how a Christian should be. It gives them that example. You know, as we look at these 2 points, the requirement of the Christian and how a Christian should be recognized. You know, here in the passage that we read in our text there in Mark, Jesus was preparing to return, to ascend back up into heaven. But his mind was on not just those disciples and the Christians that were gathered around there at that moment. His mind was on us. How can we say that? Because he recorded it in his word for us to read today. He wants us to be prepared. He wanted them to be prepared for the day when they would be given the responsibility of sharing the gospel. He was preparing them for that moment. And it came pretty quick. He ascended in Acts chapter 1, chapter 2. Guess what happens? Boom, they're getting busy. We see over 3,000 souls get saved. Pretty quick, huh? God starts using them. They had to get to work pretty quick. Folks, the day that God saved you, he started preparing you and changing you. And he gave you the responsibility of sharing the truth, including the gospel, with the world. You became a steward of that. It came with salvation. He gave the Great Commission, and he sent these people out to tell the world about him. You think about this. Our Lord's final thoughts while he was getting ready to leave was getting the gospel to the world. You know, the truth of the gospel is still the single most important message that we have to share with the world today. Don't get me wrong when I say this. We need to pray for our government. We need to pray for our leaders. And if we do what's right, it will affect them. We can have an effect on them. But you know what our main job is in relation to them? Yes, pray for them, but to see them saved. If we would be more focused instead of just, you know, and I'm just as guilty. I hear the news and I get so upset sometimes with what I hear, the decisions being made in Congress and these new laws that they pass here and what they're doing here, wasting. It's just, it boggles my mind what they do. But I can either get mad at them, get frustrated with them, or I can start focusing more on why don't we just start spreading the gospel and try and win them to the Lord. Now, I don't know. I don't know if anybody in here would ever have the chance to witness to President Biden. I don't know. I'd love to. I'd love to. But we can start with our neighbor. Start with our co-workers. We can be a good steward with where God has placed us. A good steward of the truth right here. Listen, you are impacted. You were impacted. Whether you understood it or not, growing up, and you know, especially if you grew up in church, when somebody gave you that first track, you may not have cared less what was in that track. Or when somebody knocked on your door and invited you to church and gave you a brochure, however you heard the gospel, you probably cared less with what they had to say. Maybe you did. Maybe the first time you heard it, you got saved. I don't know. But it affected you from that point on. The message that we share tonight with the truth of the gospel, we affect people every day with what we do for, with it. How we're a steward of the gospel tomorrow, this church, this number of people right here, literally, we can probably affect hundreds of people this week with the way we're a steward of the gospel, a steward of the truth. I think I shared this illustration last time when we looked at stewardship. I want to share it again. It's just such a powerful story. It's a true story. Some of you all probably remember it when we talked about it the last time. We know the story of the Titanic, the ship that went down. April 14th, 1912, said to be the unsinkable ship. Of the 2,223 people on board, only 706 of those people survived. 1,523 people ended up in the water. Out of those people, only 6 of them were rescued. So we see it, we know, we're familiar with this story. I know we're all familiar with it. You know, one of those 6 people were actually saved twice that night. This is his testimony. His story of an inspiring reminder is an inspiring reminder that there's more to life than just survival physically. To tell this man's story, we have to first tell you about another man. He was a Scottish preacher. You've heard of him before. His name was John Harper. John Harper. You ever get a chance to read a book on John Harper, I encourage you to read it. Harper boarded the Titanic with his 6-year-old daughter, Nana. He planned to travel to the Moody Church in Chicago, where he had been invited to preach for 3 months. He was going to be preaching at that church. When the ship struck that iceberg, it began to sink. Harper made sure that his daughter was placed into one of the lifeboats. Then he began what would be the last evangelistic work of his life. As the freezing waters began to fill the ship, Harper was heard shouting above all the other sailors and crewmen, "Let the women, children, and the unsaved into the lifeboats first." Survivors reported that Harper took off with his own life jacket and gave it to another man. And when he gave it to him, he said, "Don't worry about me. I'm not going down. I'm going up." When the ship began to sink, like we said, more than 1,523 people, passengers, jumped or fell into the icy waters. As they gradually drowned or froze to death there in the water, Harper was seen swimming from one passenger to another, pleading with them to accept Christ. Only 6 of the 1,500 people, roughly people, struggling in the water were rescued, including a man who later identified himself as Harper's last convert. This young man had climbed up on a piece of debris, and Harper, by this time he was struggling to stay above the water, he shouted out to this man, "Are you saved?" The man replied, "No." Harper then shouted the words from Scripture, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." The man did not answer him. After a moment, the currents drifted them away from one another, and then a few minutes later, by chance, they came back together again. Harper asked them again, "Are you saved?" The man answered once again, "No." And with his dying breath, Harper shouted, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." As he said those words, he slipped under the waves for the last time. Then and there, the man had witnessed, that he had witnessed to, decided to give his life over to Christ. 4 years later, at a Titanic survivors meeting in Ontario, Canada, this man tearfully gave his testimony, recounting how John Harper had led him to the Lord. Now we've seen movies on the Titanic, documentaries on the Titanic. I don't think they've ever put that in a documentary. But you know, every person here tonight is either like John Harper or the one he witnessed to. You're either a steward of the gospel, responsible for witnessing to every person that's drowning in sin, or you're one of the ones that needs to hear the gospel because you're drowning in your sin. You know, if you don't know the Lord as your Savior, just like that man there, call upon the Lord and ask Him to save you. But Christian, you're here tonight. You said, that part's taken care of. I know I'm saved. Know that you're a steward of the gospel. You're a steward of the truth. I understand when we go out these doors tonight, it's cold outside. It's chilly. We're not in icy waters, praise the Lord. But you know, we look outside these windows right now, these cars going by, I guarantee you, most of them going by are lost and dying and going to hell. And here we have the answer. We have the truth. We have exactly what they need. This week, how many of them are going to hear it from us? How many of the people we talk to this week are even going to know that we go to a church, that we're a Christian? But what we can tell so much more, we can tell them the gospel. We're stewards of that, folks. That's our responsibility. It's our responsibility not just to share the gospel like he was doing, swimming from passenger to passenger. He wasn't worried about keeping warm. He wasn't worried about finding a bigger piece of debris for himself so he can climb up on it and possibly get rescued. No, he was only concerned about, does that person, do they know the Lord? How about this person? Do they know the Lord? He's dying. He's taking his last breaths, and his only concern is that man gets saved. If you are saved, the Lord's parting words there in the book of Mark, and also in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Those words are a call for you and I to get busy. They're a call for you and I to be a steward of the truth. They're a call for you and I to be a steward of our testimony. You know, as we look at these last couple of weeks going into stewardship, being a steward of the truth is a lifelong, I don't want to say job, responsibility. We never stop. Being a steward of your testimony is something that never stops. Not till we die and go to heaven, amen? But we're not there yet. We need to be asking God day after day after day as we grow in the Lord that He helps us become a better testimony, a better ambassador. That Christ's life can be seen more through the way we live. That's being a good test or a good steward of our testimony. Heads bowed and eyes closed. As the musicians are coming, let me just ask you, are you being a good steward of what we've looked at? Pastor preached this as well this morning, being a good steward of our testimony and such. You're going to hear it more throughout the month. Please let God speak to our hearts about being a good steward. being a good steward of our testimony. Let me just ask you this. What can change in your life that can cause your testimony to be more like Christ? I think if we sat here and we prayed and we asked God to deal with our hearts long enough, we can find something that can change. Something that can be better. How are we this week, this past week, how were we about being a good steward of the truth? Especially with what we looked at here tonight with the gospel. What if John Harper had decided just to worry about himself, make sure he was okay? I wonder how many people would not have been saved that night and would have died and gone to hell had John Harper not been a good steward of the truth. What an example he left for us. What about us tonight? Father, I pray that you'll just bless this invitation. Speak to our hearts, Lord. If we need to come forward and deal with things, Lord, I pray folks will come to the altar. God, help us to be better stewards of the gospel and of the truth. Lord, of our testimony. I pray that you'll bless. In Jesus' name I do pray. Amen. Let's all stand. Number 10, if you need your hymnal. I have decided to follow Jesus. The invitation is open.
Messages we're hearing on the stewardship. Amen. We really are. Of course, there's one that contains 66 books. And it tells us exactly how to do that. Amen. Amen. Well, stay warm. We're about to leave here. So, anyway, be in prayer for the rest of the month. Pray for those that are ill. Pray for Sister Paula to get well. And all the others that are not well. They'll get well as their illness, okay? All right, let's bow in prayer. Let's be dismissed. Brother Roger, do that for us. Amen. God bless you.